Hi. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Santiago Guerra. I'm an assistant professor of Southwest Studies. So today, I have the honor and pleasure of introducing our lecturer who's visiting us here at Colorado College as part of our Southwest Week celebration. So just so you have an idea of what this evening's events are going to look like, once I'm done with our introduction, Patrisia is going to go ahead and come up and share with us some of this great knowledge that she has. And then afterwards, we'll follow up with a Q&A session. And then if you're interested, if all this knowledge interests you, we do have copies of Red Medicine for sale outside. So after the Q&A, if you're interested in purchasing any of these books, you can head outside, and then shortly thereafter, Patrisia will join us outside for some more private conversation and book signing. Great. So we have this great moment here at Colorado College to share with a really great scholar and a great practitioner in the realm of indigenous medicine. Patrisia comes to us from the University of Arizona, where she is an associate professor of Mexican American Studies and also heavily involved with the Native American Research Center at the University of Arizona. I especially am really happy to have Patrisia here because she really does a lot in terms of her practice as a practitioner and as a scholar. And as a Chicano who is descended from the pre-Hispanic people that inhabited the continents of the Americas, her work really does a great deal to help us reflect on the legacy of genocide, both material and cultural, in the Americas, and does a great work in uniting those of us people that are descended from these original inhabitants. And it offers us a great opportunity to really think about the place of these practices, the future of these practices, and what we can do for our own communities as Chicanos, as Native people, and for our different sort of groups as we move forward in thinking about what these practices mean for our ancestors and really what it can do for us in the present. And so I really hope that y'all take this great opportunity that we have with Patrisia being here to really open up your heart and open up your minds and really reflect on what this type of knowledge means to those of us who have either been forced out of these practices or who have made our greatest efforts to struggle to retain these practices in the midst of the genocide that we don't often enough recognize here in the Americas. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Patrisia Gonzales to present.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me to come here. I'm really honored. And I was saying a little prayer while you were talking for all our grandmas who maintain this knowledge from life to life in our gardens, in our living rooms, sometimes in a bathroom, an old abandoned bathtub where they put their saints in on the front lawn. Those secret and sacred things that we held privately to take care of our children. And as I was sitting there, I was thinking about all our grandmas, and all the things that they gave us in our medicine, all the different kinds of medicine that our families carry as human beings. And I was thinking about the Mother Mountain here, these beautiful mountains, and I asked permission from these beautiful, powerful beings that have accumulated over time parts of the earth that have become these mountains and the waters that stream from the top of those mountains down into your rivers and streams and all of the guardians and all the people that might be buried there and all of the good thoughts that have been taken there, all the good feelings that we feel when we're near the mountains and the beautiful waterways of this place. And with that, I ask for permission to come and talk to you today. And so we're talking about the unseen. And yet I'm going to have, I have like 40 slides. Because the unseen is experienced, it's felt, it's experienced through relationships. So as I mentioned, our grandmas, and I mentioned our mother mountains here, and the beautiful mother streams, and the grandmas and grandpas of life that are here, the great parents of the universe, the great parents that are creators, that is the unseen. And sometimes it's through stories of the words we say, that about how we think about life, that is part of the unseen. So part of the unseen are our stories and the words that we use. And yet it's seen, because we can write that word down if we have a written language. It's unseen, and yet it's something that was taught to you. Somehow you learned it, and it was passed on from life to life to make us who we are as human beings. So I'm beginning with some pictures from the Hubble, because I'm going to talk a little bit about the sacred and the unseen. And so that's the Ant Nebula. And so the Ant Nebula, one of my Indian names means the ant who carries the corn. So I like to bring my relative up here in the sky. And so this is what they named it. This is what Hubble named it, the Ant Nebula. And so even the forms that we, we were talking about indigenous medicine, and yet we have scientists looking there and saying, wow, that looks like an ant, and naming it. And it's very similar to the experiences that our ancestors had as they began to name the places, to give words to experience, and to have a relationship with this being that we call the universe, that we call the life force, that we call creator or God, or the names we give to the power that makes life pulse. So I guess I have to do this myself, huh? Okay. So this is a lineage of my family. I don't think if I move the cursor, oh, it does, okay. Because of time, I won't go into details, but this is my great-grandma, Kickapoo grandmother from my father's side. Oops, disappeared. This is my great-grandma, Kickapoo grandma from my mother's side. This is my Comanche grandma, who was married to him, who was a Nahuan Mexican traditional healer, very well-known curandero. And this was his son. And this, my grandma, was her daughter. And these grandparents raised me for the first 10 years of my life. And they carried medicine. And he was a very well-known bone setter and traditional healer with ceremony. And this was my other great-grandma from my dad's side. And she was a midwife and caught babies in the 1800s in San Antonio and Waco and all of that part of Texas. And these are Nahua or Masawal elders. That are my teachers that have helped me to continue learning. And this is Doña Filomena and Don Aurelio, who are mentioned in the book for those of you who have read Red Medicine, or if you read Red Medicine. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how we've come to know. So I recognize that knowledge as the knowledge that I carry, and I have permission from my family and from these elders to talk about Red Medicine. And they asked me to, and when I asked for permission to write Red Medicine, they gave me permission to actually talk about a lot of things that I didn't put in Red Medicine because of the profound nature of the knowledge and the concern I had about what happens when you put it into a text. But I wrote around things. I wrote around things so that, because Don Aurelio is very concerned about the ability of people to survive into the future. And so part of my journey with Red Medicine was to document the knowledge of elders who came together in 1992 to talk about prophecies, to talk about predictions, and what was the state of the world, the state of the planet. And his great concern, Don Aurelio's great concern, of what knowledge do we need to know as human beings today to survive and to continue. So you're going to hear me talk about maybe some terms in short term, like TIM, which stands for Traditional Indigenous Medicine. MTM sometimes stands for Mesoamerican Traditional Medicine, or Mexican Traditional Medicine, or Masawal or Nahua Traditional Medicine. I love these images because here is some turtle medicine, and my grandma carried turtle medicine as part of her healing ways. And this is a depiction of a little typical shop you might find it anywhere in Mexico or anywhere in the Southwest where there might be Mexican or indigenous origin peoples. So part of my journey, part of the medicine I carry is the ability to see. And this is the cover to Red Medicine, which is a contemporary depiction of my time of when I was born and all the powers that were present based on the Mesoamerican calendars. This is a traditional one that was painted. This painter actually is in the book, Martha Ramirez Oropresa. This is the traditional one that she painted on a mate paper that shows the powers, part of the powers. When you open it up, it actually shows about 20 presences, 20 functions in the universe that make up part of who I am. And this is a traditional way of counting, of measuring time of a person's life at the time of conception, and how that life, the powers that can influence that person's capabilities and in a lifetime. And part of that medicine is this being that has prayer ties for eyes. And those prayer ties, we're going to see later, represent the ability to have great insight. So you don't need eyes, as in the physical eye, because you carry the sight of star knowledge and stellar knowledge. So this is actually a pre-Columbian image. This was from the Borgia Codex, and it's at least 1,000 years old. And this is a birthing being. Do I have any midwives in the audience? No? Any birth workers? Any women who have birthed at home? any women who have birthed? How many moms and grandmas do I have here? All right. So you know that place that you went into deep inside of yourself to bring that baby forward. And this is depicting that incredible process of when women birth, they open up to the universe, as Doña Enriqueta, a Zapotec midwife, has taught us. And so her eyes carry prayer ties, and these prayer ties of the white, made in white light are the light of the morning star, of Venus. And she's birthing, and in fact, there's a little midwife catching the baby right there, and there are all these other little midwives making offerings, and then here we see a baby being, not a human baby, but some small being that is given its first bath. So we have instructions here of how to birth. The point here is that the great insight that is depicted here is the insight that's coming from the cosmos. And so it is, again, when we talk about the unseen world, when we try to document how do we understand what we know, how do we understand how the universe works, sometimes we have to have a shared teaching to help us do this. And so those of you who look at this may not know where to look, because you've been trained to read in a certain kind of way. You may not know those symbols, but the people who are in relationship with those symbols, particularly people who still live with those symbols in daily life, then can connect that to the way to live, what to do, how to treat birth, what to do at birth, how to understand and help a woman go inside of herself, and even the remembering of the importance of the prayers that could be offered at the first bath of a child. So what is the unseen? So I teach classes on traditional medicine, and by the way, Santiago, keep me on time with, you know, okay, because I'll just keep going, like, you know. I didn't bring my clock up here. You know, we really try to look at these words, because the words that we have in English or Spanish or any of the European languages don't express the indigenous philosophies that are condensed into any native language with its own thought system. And so we use words like, you know, you'll see people describing TIM or MTM, some of the scholars, as magical and mystical and gods, and yet what does that mean to say that something is, it should if native people consider it to be great philosophical systems, do they or we really want to call our knowledge magical or magic? Magical has another connotation, but to call something magic, right? So I asked my students, so you've heard of the term medicine man, so if something, if this medicine is magic, would you call him a magic man? How does that feel to call someone a magic man? What does that connote? And it's these ascribing of something as magic, as mystical, given its context, that is really about people not having sufficient words or using words in a shortcut to talk about these very profound experiences that people don't understand. How is it that there are these great traditional healers that when sometimes allopathic medicine hasn't worked, someone will go into a ceremony and have remission of some very life-threatening illness or take away trauma. So it's and so it, understanding these processes within that framework of an indigenous society is very important. And so I call it the unseen, the seen and the unseen. And another way it would be to call it sacred. But when we come to understand, well, why is something sacred? Right? What makes something sacred? And we often get drawn to the very physical presence of a powerful native ceremony, beautiful ceremony, and its sacredness. But underlying that sacredness of that ceremony has been thousands of years of relationship with an environment in very difficult times in which human beings evolved and learned how to survive in harsh conditions. And that's where the sacred comes from. It comes from seeking to continue, seeking to preserve life when we didn't have the same kind of coverage and the comforts of today. And that knowledge was a hard-won knowledge, and it's something that we may go back to, because if we lose our water, all of us are going to have to learn to have that sacred relationship with water. And the day that you learn to be able to bathe with a cup of water because you have to, that's the day then when we will really appreciate the water, and that will be that sacred relationship. And I think that it may come to that in some places where we will be relying on a cup of water, if we're lucky, to bathe, given what we're going through now with our environment. So part of understanding the unseen is understanding this aliveness, and so here I have a nice big depiction of the ant nebula. I want to tell an ant story a little bit later on about the power of carrying a name such as the ant. I just was visiting a friend at a pueblo, and there was a big ant hill, and he was like, "Move your truck this way," and I was like, "But I'm going to go over the ant hill," you know. And you don't want to go over the ant hill, right? You know, like, I'm going over my relatives. It's like I'm walking on top of their house. Would you want to put your car over someone's house, right? Would you want somebody to run their car into your house? And yet we build on ant hills all the time. People build on ant hills all the time. But I know that I would get in trouble with my ant relatives. So again, this sacred then and this unseen comes from these agreements that people started to make in time immemorial of human memory, and with not only each other, but with these living beings such as the ant people. And one of the ways it gets reflected is even our clan system among American Indian people. So very often our clans will be named after an animal or an insect or a bird. So those people that have that knowledge also have a particular relationship with that particular non-human entity, and yet they have peopledom, and we respect them as having their own rights. And medicine societies can grow out of that, such as it's recorded among the Zuni of the ant society, and there's a particular illness that's associated with being out of balance with the ants. And so how could that happen? Well, we have in our language, what do we say about ants? Like, what are some, you know, kind of cliches about ants when kids are like, ants in your pants, so what kind of, you know, itching, right? And so one of the illnesses sometimes ascribed to ants is people get itchiness and skin rashes among some tribal peoples. So I love this one. This is apparently a place where stars are born. Again, this is from the Hubble. Aren't these lovely? I mean, they're not paintings. They're actually photographs, right? Yeah. And so how do we come to be? How does the universe work? These are really the questions beyond this concept of the unseen and the sacred. So it's important for us to think about why do we call something sacred? Why do we call something holy? Why do we call something witchcraft? It's the value we give to it. And so when we start to, you know, when I talk to students, I say, well, what do you mean by this? Then we have to have these long explanations. And of course, if you were sitting with an elder and they were to ask you about these things, they would probably tell a very long story and not ever tell it to you directly, which my elders often did to me and often do to me. And I'd have to think about it and come up with my own words about how I've come to understand this. So I call it cosmologic. Since we have cosmological, I think, well, there must be a cosmologic, right? There's its own inherent kind of making sense of the world. And this is all to lead up to some things that I'm going to show you. So when we think about, I'm sorry, you know, the computer crashed today, and I see that it messed up the slide when I was trying to retype it. So I love what Sean Wilson says, that indigenous knowledge is the relationship. So what is indigenous knowledge? It's the relationship we have with these things. And so I actually, for a diabetes camp of Native youth, I did a lecture on traditional medicine, and I talked about, this is an image from the Library of the National Library of Medicine. It's an archival image of a medicine man. And he's got a gourd, he's got animal pelts hanging, he's got some medicine, it's kind of hard to see here, but he's got some medicine boiling, or has been boiled in this, in a container here, and he's preparing some medicine. And then there's stacks of fibers and these kinds of things, and of course he's in a traditional structure. And so I think, what were the relationships for him to get that gourd? Was this gourd something wild from the environment? Were these seeds saved? What are the prayers being said? How did he know to do this? Who taught him? These are all within a relationship of knowledge. And that, I think, is what makes it different than when people extricate the knowledge of indigenous people and then try to make it their own. It then has a different relationship. And it's often criticized as not having the same power as when it's firmly situated within that indigenous context of understanding the sacred, of having these great honoring, a way of honoring these powers of the living universe, that keep a sense of accountability toward our medicine in a way that reminds us that we shouldn't charge for many of our traditions. Many of the knowledge keepers don't charge. It may vary from tribe and community, but for the most part, people are very aware that because this comes from that origins of life, the originating relationships, that it's something that should be treated in such a way. I show an image of God, and he's like, of Jesus, and people are coming to him, and he's like, so, you know, he's giving his price fee for consultation with Jesus, and they totally get it. So this is the birth of time, and so, again, this is a pre-Columbian codex that shows us, actually, it looks like a brain to me. It's not very good, it's not very clear here, but you can see right here this kind of half moon form, and then there's spiders in there, and this is considered a depiction of the birth of time. But what I want to show is that even time is shown, or the birth of time is shown as alive, and undulating and moving. And when we think about, well, what do we mean by time? What is that word, time? We have this word in English that says it's time, this is time, but what would be an indigenous concept of time, moving and undulating? And so maybe time in a language could mean movement, movement from one point to another, movement in cycles of different points. A language, a word could capture time in that way in our Nahuatl language. And so sometimes the unseen is something all around us, and sometimes it's emerging from within to help the people, and sometimes it's coming from without when we call on powers to help us. And so I'm going to walk around, and so this won't be captured on the video, and that's actually a good thing, because I want you to experience something. So what shifts did you feel when I walked around with those plants? I'm asking for some audience feedback here.
Curiosity,
okay. Yes.
There was a sense of coolness, followed by a sense of heat, followed by a sense of almost cleansing.
Mm-hmm.
There was a fragrance, a floral type scent that came through.
It's still there. You can still, some of it, still in my hand. So we can explain this from a scientific framework as the volatile oils in these plants. Many of these plants I gathered right outside, what was the name of the building?
Dern House,
yes. Some I brought from my mom's land in Texas. But if we go back to this idea of the unseen, of the spirit within those plants, and the way the plants were gathered, and the way that I have been taught to treat the plants, and understanding these plants may have physical names and ceremonial names, such as what people know as mugwort here in Nahua is, one of its names is istiaut, which means kind of the white watery plant. It's associated with a sacred female presence in the salt. And it has physical properties, but it was also the Spanish attempted to eradicate it because it was used so much in ceremony. But this plant will grow in the desert, it will grow in by rivers, it cannot be eradicated. And so it was hidden, and it grows all over the Southwest and in other kinds of, it has other names also. In Texas, a lot of the Apaches also use this medicine. So that relationship with that plant, we know that it survived despite the great efforts to annihilate it. But I love what Greg Cajete says, who wrote Native Science, and he's quoted a lot in the slides. You know, that plants represent, you know, that weed that breaks through the concrete represents that will to live, the impulse of life. And that impulse of life and that little weed reminds us of the sacred. It reminds us of the unseen will. Right? The will, you can't see it until it manifests breaking through that concrete, and that's the will to live. And that same power in that plant to break through that concrete is the same power we have as human beings in our lives to live, to continue, to make innovations, to respond to the challenges of being a human being in this planet. So these are examples, again, of, this is actually a Mayan codex. And what I want to show you just is here, there's a weaver. And I work a lot with the Mesoamerican spider woman. So weaving, she comes up in these images a lot, both among the Nahua and the Mayan, and also among the Mixtec codexes. Here we have people smoking cigars up towards the heavens. Now this is the ceremonial tobacco. The ceremonial tobacco that's offered as a way to open up the skies, to make an offering to the creator or creators. And I love what Tom Porter says, who is from among the Haudenosaunee people, that when they light their tobacco, creator's so busy, but creator stops to listen, right? So when we stop and say, I have to make a prayer now, and we make this offering to open up that place for the creator to listen to us. And so you hear a lot of things, words used in academia, and they'll talk about this idea of this liminality, this transitional space. And yet I think of experience, and I think actually that it's actually more the idea of it being latent, that within, when we go back to the idea of the unseen being able to emerge out of, let's say, the plants. Here I added some water, and then with my good heart and the things and the prayers I was thinking as we were sitting, you know, I put that into the plant, and I had a talk with the plant. And so that latent spirit of that plant then came, and it spoke to you all in different ways, and you heard, and you felt the hot and the cold, and the wave, and somebody else might have felt something or not at all, right? But it's that latent potential of life in there, and it interacts with that person also, and their latent, their potential to be able to experience something. So part of what I work with also is dreams and time as medicine. And this is actually a very important glyph showing first man and first woman, Oshomoko and Sipaktonal. They are casting corn. She's actually looking and she's got a little bag, and she's throwing corn to make a diagnosis, and he's carrying a gourd of tobacco. And so these same practices continue today among many indigenous traditional healers in Mexico. And so we think, well, how is it that something continues to be? And we know that this is recorded about the 1500s. This might have been painted in the late 1500s. And 500 years later, despite this ongoing oppression of medicine, that there are elders, grandmas and grandpas who have maintained these traditions, even when they're not identified, no longer have maybe their ethnic identification as an Indian people. They may have lost their Indian name, or their town may no longer be recognized as being Nahuatl or whatever traditional pueblo that they might be from. They continue those practices. And it's that repetition that's been maintained over time. This is also another depiction of the corn. And we actually see the very important role that traditional women have held in Mexico. And so it's estimated that 65% of traditional healers in Mexico are women. And this, and a real key foundation of that is the medicine that's within the home. And it's called domestic medicine in Spanish. That's how it translates in English. And so part of the power of maintaining the unseen is that it was brought into the homes after this, after colonization happened, and I'm going to talk about this. So one of the concepts that Lopez Austin talks about is that there is this strong nucleus of Mesoamerica, this civilization where there was sharing of knowledge and across a wide region, and it keeps like readjusting and resonating, and yet there are these consistencies and these ways that different native peoples do things similarly, not uniformly, but that show us, that give us examples of how strong that indigenous knowledge was because of the sharing and that depth of a civilization that could not be eradicated with genocide. And so this is actually put out by midwives, the Tisimi Project out of Guanajuato. And you see that this is a very traditional way of us to help a birth, is to gently press on the belly, to just gently encourage the descent of the baby. This is a Mayan base that's about 800 AD. It's really beautifully painted, but this line drawing depicts the same hand movements, okay? And actually, there's a grandma, and she's holding onto a bowl, and she's speaking. And this woman, this being, because these are not human beings per se, is holding onto a birthing rope. And the midwife is, you can see there are these arms crossed, gently pressing on the stomach, except this midwife is a Jagger midwife because she has Jagger paws. And so in birth, a traditional way that I conduct birth and that I understand birth is that there are birth powers present. This unseen part of birth that help us. Some of the teachings share that we have these, that midwives, when they die, that work is so holy, they go up into the heavens in the holy place, and they help in those births when it's time. And they throw out their beautiful rebozo and help bring the medicine to the birthing woman. And so this is held by different people, including Doña Ermila, who taught us to recognize the midwives that were in our family or our teachers who have gone into spirit world when we would say a prayer. And so it's a similar concept of this idea that there are cosmological presences, female presences happening at birth. And so this helps us to understand how we understand birth as traditional midwives from my tradition and how it's depicted in this cosmological birth. It's cosmologic in a Mayan base. And then this is a present day depiction of birth from the indigenous doctors of Mexico. They created this book called La Medicina Maya, and they're doing a birth, you know, check. And then you have all of these powers also present, and they're doing their ceremonial calendar count. And this ceremonial spiritual guide is there overseeing the birth and the influence. So these are about the female influences that could happen at birth. Sometimes, this is from an altar at Clinica Tecocoli, which is a clinic that was started by some young Masawal doctors who are the children of Don Aurelio. And so this is a ceremonial place that centers their experience of their medicine. So sometimes you may see a physical form, and yet what makes it powerful, right? What gives it that potency? What gives it that the impact, the ability to produce some kind of effect? And it is prayer, and it is faith, and it is the taking care of these things in the way that I'm talking about. So with colonization, people had to, and sorry for the any typos here, I had fixed it, but again, with the with my computer glitch today, I want to show this one instead. This depicts the massive, so these pre-Columbian images were books, painted books, and thousands of them were killed. Yeah, thousands of them were killed because these books were considered living and alive. But these as a depiction of the massive book burnings, and one account says that it took a week to burn all of these painted books. And what we see here, what do you think you're looking at? Anybody want to throw out some descriptions? It's a burning of what? I can't hear. What? Yeah, yeah, exactly. Exactly. So what is being burned are these formulas, these sacred formulas. And so what they're depicting is the trauma of the death of their knowledge in its painted form. So these unseen becomes enmasked in the Catholic, very much in the Catholic. So you felt and experienced some of the scene when I walked around, you smelt it. Sometimes you hear it in a song, or you might hear it through the wind. But a lot of our home altars and our gardens became the sacred sites, became the ceremonial sites. But just as sacred as are those altars is the kitchen table. How many of us love our kitchen tables? Yes. Some of the best conversations, we eat our food that we love, all our papers pile up on it. I like to take my sewing machine and put it on the kitchen table, right? It is a sacred space. And of course now with the food movement we now know, you know, it's even more important that and our gardens. So, you know, because I got invited to come speak here when I wasn't, I'm not in Tucson right now, I'm on a sabbatical, I had to kind of pull up pictures from what I had available. So this is a shrine from Chumamok Hill, and it's a beautiful shrine of actually a site that was originally an Autham site, a sacred site, and it's become a public site for Tucson. And then this is a botanical garden, a depiction of a Mexican barrio garden. And so I think one of the best parts of this is actually this chair right here. How many of people have you remember your grandma or grandpa sitting on those kind of chairs, right? Yes, you do. Okay. It's sacred, you know? I still have my grandma's rocking chair. It's fallen apart, but her DNA is still on it. And if there's time, I can talk about that. So I want to talk about how we see these forms start to align, and that helps to help us unite as Indigenous people across the Americas. This is actually right after the conquest, a depiction of the pre-Columbian Temezcal, the Nahua name for the sweat lodge or the sweat house. It was run by women, still largely run by women, but it's changing. And this is a depiction of a ceremony. She's actually healing a man who's ill, and she's talking to him. And then this is a current day one in Oaxaca. And then this is another one from the 1800s that was it's an American Indian lodge, and it's lost its, unfortunately, when I lost my PowerPoint, I think it lost the citation on it. I think it may be Cheyenne, but I don't know now. So, but I want to just recognize that these forms, right? These are ceremonies, and they are shared across the continent. They can vary, but I just wanted to show you that this one is made out of adobe, and this one is made from hides and reed, and that even the way you will enter these ceremonial places changes the way you are in the world, because you're no longer standing upright. There's a certain way to enter, and very often there are instructions that are sacred, teachings about how you should enter into this place to go into this ceremony. And so even knowing those gestures is part of that unseen knowledge that actually is very experienced when you get on your knees to and are connected directly to our mother or grandmother Earth, going into this sacred place that for us, in my teachings, for my Nahua way, is the womb. This is actually a temezcal built in Calpulli Izcalli, which is in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and we brought one of the first temezcalas with permission from the elders from Mexico, and this was the second one that we built there. And you can see, they haven't put the roof on it, so you can see the light reflecting into it. And this is really important because I'm not going to talk about the sweat lodge ceremonies. They're very different. They vary from tradition to tradition. But to realize, to remember that even the way the doors are placed, there are, it's a sacred architecture, for lack of a better word. It's a sacred structure. And it's placed within an orientation of the sacred directions of life. When we pray, there are prayers recognizing the power of Venus, the power of the moon, the power of the star beings, all that's above us, along with the recognition of the fire, the recognition of the power of the earth that we're sitting on. And here we see, before it's closed, exactly how that upward world is asserting onto this physical, earthly world. Okay. So in our way, in the Nahua way, it's treated as alive, it is fed, it has guardians, it has what might be translated as godparents. There are ceremonies for the very first initiation of it, before we even build it. There are all kinds of ceremonies that we do. And so that shows you the great care that is given towards this beautiful grandmother that is a sacred womb that we are allowed to enter. And this is, sometimes it's called the Xochicalli, and this is one in which there's flowers. I'm going to skip ahead and not talk about this so much. What I want to say about time as medicine is that when ceremonies work, it can undo the past. And that's the part that people try to understand. How is it I can get better when nothing else worked, right? How is it that I can finally let go of that we've been going to the therapist for the longest time about? And actually, it can work really well to go to the therapist and then go to a ceremony, because you only get 45 minutes with the therapist, and the ceremony could be all night and you can really heal. But I think doing both is makes sense. You know, I mean, they can be, you know, supportive of each other. But that is the power, that if a ceremony can be effective, particularly when it's related to a trauma, then we are undoing the past, because we're undoing the effect that past has had on our souls and our spirits. I don't mean the occidental soul. And so in Spanish, that concept of the soul and the soul wound is known as susto. We also have other names for it in the Nahuatl language, but it means the loss of your tonal, the loss of your sun, your internal sun, which can be, it's like another vital force. So we know that we talk a lot about, you know, our spirit and our soul, and those are kind of two accepted terms we have in the United States. But in traditional Nahua, both pre-Columbian and present, you have other vital forces. And so you actually have various spirits that are alive within you, and they can be left. They can be left during a traumatic event. Or it's almost like the idea of disassociation, and part of you has been left. That's kind of a parallel idea, except that we bring that part of you back in ceremony, and we integrate you back, and you're returned to be made part of yourself again. And so these are depictions of purification ceremonies. This, we know that it's pre-Columbian. These are words that are used by many different people for the ceremony, one of the ceremonies that's used to treat this soul wounding. So let's not look at this image, but I want to just say that Carmen Lomas Garza's work is really important. I mean, what I mean is, because we're filming, I want to respect her images, so I'm not going to stay on that image. But I want to recognize that she's documented some really important work of these Texas grandmothers doing the limpias purification and using brooms to do the purification. That was one of the ways my grandmother did her ceremonies. And she would just pick up the broom and start doing the sweeping ceremony. And so sometimes, though, we use a broom of herbs. And in that prior slide that I was showing you about, the first slide about the purification ceremony, it was similar, a similar form of a broom of herbs. And that's how they're referred to, as a broom of herbs. And so in the ceremony, then, the person is allowed to recalibrate through, as Don Aurelio says, the person recalibrates through and refines its balance again through nature and finds its power again, because its power has been depleted from a certain interaction, a trauma, difficult, a sudden loss, even things like shame and embarrassment. And so we actually have people in Mexico who are particular doctoring of the healing of shame and doctoring for the healing of mortification. And so these are things now, this idea of depression is actually just a term that we've agreed upon, but when you look up, try to diagnose depression, there's like at least 20 symptoms, right? And so indigenous people understood that your emotions could affect your health, right? You could go out of balance. And of course, now we know with stress hormones and all of the physiological things that happen with stress and emotions. Yes? She's actually holding a caiman, I believe. It's a form of a lizard, which is animal medicine that could be used as part of a purification. And there was a well-known traditional healer in the Mercado Sonora in Mexico City, and you could go there, and she would do all her limpias with frogs. Frogs. So animal medicine can be part of what is taking off the sickness from the person. And this is from the traditional medicine museum in Morelos, and this is depiction of an offering at an anthill for someone who's gotten sick from having disturbed the balance and the relationship with the ant. And sometimes this is related to a lot of falling down. Sometimes it's related to a lot of skin eruptions. It can also be related to being very agitated or having a soul wound. And so the person's spirit, there is an offering to the anthill so that the person, so that the anthill, the winds will release that person so that they can find balance again. So it's been termed magical fright, and which of course, even prior to Rubel, but in fact, it's, as you can see, a far more complex understanding of how the soul can be lost, captured, wounded, displaced, and how it has to be reintegrated into the person and also reintegrated in balance with its with the physical world. So how does knowledge come back? This is a big question for people who've been disconnected, because the unseen, part of what we have to recognize about the unseen world is the things we no longer see and do anymore as a result of oppression, as a result of being told that the power in your hands was evil. That's really what it boiled down to. Many of the women from Europe to the Americas were persecuted because they had a relationship with plants, they had powerful hands, they had the ability to have sight. All of these things that I'm showing you about the importance of having internal sight was why they were persecuted, for using very powerful medicines like the peyote. And yet, it's been sustained within these families. And I'm not going to show the video since they can't be streamed live. But one of the parts of the unseen that makes it very different than alternative medicine is the understanding of who has the right to heal, or who has the ability to heal, and how the ability to heal comes to you. And this, in Spanish, it's translated as a don. And I actually had a good translation of it, but I lost that in the thing too. Oh well, yeah, I get to tell you what it means. So I've come up, as far as the people who know Spanish and know this term, the definition of el don as the inherited or bestowed, inherent capacity, and that bestowed inherent capacity is bequeathed from creation. And so it's It's often said that if there's a traditional healer in your family, then it will be inherited throughout the generations. It's within a bloodline. Or you, because you have a family of healers, you know, you're in that environment, so you learn and you're given the lineage to carry. Or you're also trained through apprenticeship, such as plant knowledge, you know, being in that environment. And so Don Aurelio talks about there's this the ray that comes from the sky. And sometimes too, it's from finding objects, like midwives, if they make certain dreams, certain things, and then if they find certain things, it's an indication that they should become midwives. And so because my great grandmother was a midwife and my great grandpa was a traditional healer and one of my great aunts was also a traditional healer, both my grandmothers carried medicine and my grandpa carried medicine. I inherited that lineage in my family. And I'm only beginning to talk about inheriting that because quite frankly, you know, it's taken me a long time to understand, you know, being born into a family where it was just there and I really didn't need to do it until I got sick, you know, to use the medicine. I got very sick. I was told I would never have a normal life. I'm a rape survivor. When I was raped, I was treated through ceremony and traditional ways. So I have a lot of experience with treating sustal and have worked a lot with survivors of violence. And so with this group that I mentioned called Puliscali, we asked for permission from the elders to start to teach each other what we knew. And then I started to go back and talk to my grandma, and my great-grandpa had died, and then much later, my aunts told me that he had identified me as the person who would continue with the medicine. And then things happened when I would start to work with pregnant women, and I would hear babies in the womb, and they would tell me what they needed, and I have the ability to see into the womb. And then I had certain dreams, and the dreams were indications, as when I would go back to the elders to interpret the dreams, they will say, well, that's because you're supposed to be a midwife. And so so it made sense to me, the ability that I have. One of the last dreams that I had recently, I dreamed that I was gonna be catching a baby in the dark. And also in the dream, I had several dreams with my goddaughter, and in one of them, I was telling her, has your water broke? She goes, yes. I said, you have to tell the midwife. And she didn't want to tell the midwife. But I said, no, you have to tell the midwife. And then at the time of birth, the midwife wasn't there. And the birth came very quickly. And as soon as the water broke, I said, we have to tell the midwife. And she was like, she wasn't ready to call the midwife just yet. And I said, no, I know I have to call the midwife. I called the midwife, and 10 minutes later, the baby was born. And the midwife wasn't there. I was there. And I was catching the baby in the dark. And all the dreams we had was that it was going to be in the dark. And, you know, we weren't even going to know the sex of the baby because we were just trying to get the baby to mama. But, you know, I am a traditional, I have caught, you know, I've worked with 70 births. And not a lot, but I am like the women of my grandmother's era who knew, had enough knowledge to be able to catch babies and not afraid to be in birth and not afraid to be at the home. And because of the training that I've had over the years, the teachings that I've inherited, you know, I have a way to be able to do prayers for women, and so and to listen to the dreams, so that I will know to pay attention. And so when we started to compare our dreams, it all made sense. We had all been foreadvised that I would be catching that baby without a midwife and without a registered midwife, because I'm a traditional midwife, meaning that I'm not certified. But I do have knowledge to be able to catch a baby. So, remembering that cord in the sky. So as Don Aurelio was teaching me things, he also talked about how the birth of a child is actually a ceremony. That birth is a ceremony. And I said, Don Aurelio, how is birth a ceremony? He goes, well, you know, there's that cord in the sky, and this cord, you know, is there's the cord that feeds the baby, but then there's this cord, a cosmic cord that from the sky that feeds the life. And I talk a lot in Red Medicine about other teachings by other peoples that the baby's in the spiritual realm. In that womb, even though it's in a physical place, it's a spiritual place, it's the place of Creator. Even though it's here in that body, it's still in the spiritual world. And so then after I'm talking to him and I'm doing my work, yeah, I was not going to get a PhD. But I was offered a fellowship at the University of Wisconsin while my ex-husband was getting his PhD. And so I said, well, I'll look at birthing images, because I knew there was a lot of birthing images from the codices. And so as I went back to look at this, I found this pre-Columbian codex, which is over 1,000 years old, and is showing the baby, a birth guardian, who's cutting the cord, and the cord is attached to the night sky and the stars. And so his knowledge in oral tradition and this knowledge in the symbolic language, which even symbols don't, you know, portray the words that are contained and condensed in these teachings, which were very much ceremonial and sacred knowledge, we can see the unseen understanding, the undocumented understanding actually having been documented, and we see it physical and present. So I want to tell you about the aunt, and I was very sick. In fact, I'd had dreams that I was very ill, and an elder had warned me that I was very, very ill, and I had to take care of it. And I was doing a lot of ceremony and prayers, and I went back to Mexico to the teachers to get some purification ceremonies done. And Roberto, they had done a limpia on me, and beautiful flowers from Morelos, which flowers I've never, it's like the flowers from Hawaii, they were so odoriferous, so powerful in their medicine. And we took the flowers and we offered them at the anthill, and he saw that all the ants were carrying the flowers back to the anthill. And so then he takes more flowers, he says, oh, I'll give them more flowers, you know, but they didn't take those flowers, they only took the flowers that were on my body. And one of the elders said, you have become Tonacatepet, which is the place of sustenance. It's in the creation story about the ant and Quetzalcoatl, and the ant helps Quetzalcoatl find the corn. And my name comes from the red ant who carries the corn. And so the ants only took that which had my illness on it and my spirit and what was left from my body onto those flowers into the anthill. And I've seen this on my own, also with me. I've seen this other times, you know, in other occasions. And so the elder said, you know, I knew then that the ceremony had been completed and that I was going to be okay. And so this was an offering that I made one solstice, you know, what's known as the solstice. And my mother had given me this mantel to the Virgen. And in honor of her, I had put this out on the rocking chair, and I had put out an altar. And at the very end, you see this tiny, this was like a rock ant, right? That I put, you know, kind of as a recognition of, it was right by the front porch. You see this tiny little ant show up. And it comes up and it starts taking these flowers. And so I knew then that the ant was completing our prayers and taking them to the place of the anthill. So Richard Atlio, a Nuchana scholar out of BC, says that it's disconnection that makes us vulnerable. And so I think when we become vulnerable, we doubt the power of our prayers. We doubt that these things are real, right? We doubt that we can change our destiny, that we are headed towards that, propelled towards that arc of gravity, right? But ceremonies are so powerful that they can transcend even the physical law of gravity. So I'm going to read from Red Medicine now. Do I have enough time to read from Red Medicine? Yeah? Okay. And then questions? Okay, just a short passage, two passages. Let's see. Offer cornmeal to the above, below, all around, north, the south, east, west, north, south, center, above, below, around. Yellow pollen, blue pollen, west, north, east, south. The threads have been become tangled. Look upon the morning star, pointed uterus for the stories, the laraña. Where are your threads? Show me your red thread, your smoking thread. The ball of thread is unraveling, undoing, rewoven, recollected. We make a braid, sweetgrass braid, green grass braid, green corn braid, a tight braid, a fine braid, and wrap it around the world. Go inside the story, your night sky thread. Throw your cotton on the universe, the seven sisters, the 10 solar beings, skyward, earthward, the flower pot breaks open. The men start a fire and pray while Maria labors in my home. We laugh and eat atole with cacao for life force. The birth powers are called in, and I say words only to be said at this moment in life. Within 4 hours, she delivers her daughter. Her placenta is born in a pot, and we present this child to her other mother. We offer tobacco and corn tortillas, a velita for her tree of life. Her birth liquids on my sheets are washed with prayers. The water used to wash Maria's, quote, bloody show is returned to the milpa, cornfield. The fire stick is offered for a prayer bundle for the fallen Kualhuitecan warrior who was taken in an early death. The movement between life and death has made its cycle. For days after Maria's labor, my house is filled with her birth energy, her life. As her womb opened and contracted, the birth powers that move bones, fluids, and child emerge from the deepest layers of the physical and spiritual cosmos. Her life remains in the air, near the ceilings, near the fireplace. Her life has released ceremony. In its own body time, her energy reconstitutes in her body. This is the physical ceremonial image of energy of birth. In the arrullo murmurings of another birth, I am once again an ombligo grandmother conducting medicine prayers before the red white star eyes of the night, closing bones and cooking and cleaning during the first ceremonial count of a mother-child life. We plant her name with her ear of corn, and I knot red prayer thread and offer cotton. My grandmother would stand and face the four corners of the universe, calling the four winds that carried all of her children. She braided prayers into her hair. She would call in the ancestors, a prayer I carry with me today. She would call to our ancestors and the energies as she adhered to her ceremonial formula and sacred configurations. She whispered prayers to beings whose names we could not hear or say. This prayer is part of my spiritual genealogies from within a system of knowledge. We call in the ancestors now. We call them in because in red medicine of my life world, life is not knowable from only mental exercises. We call in the ancestors so that we know that we are never alone and to acknowledge from the spirit world we attain help. We call to them as part of living indigenous knowledge because our ancestors know who we are. Calling to the cuatro vientos, we call back our spirits from across time and space. More powerful than the generations of hurting is el gran poder, the great spirits of life, and among them are the creators of thought, movement, and measurement. Show me your thread, your blue thread, your sunweave thread, your water thread, your mica thread, your fire smoke braid, your water serpent net, your falls below thread, your smoke hairs, grass braids, tender corn braid, maguey needle thread, a tight braid, a firm net to catch, red healing hoops to thread the story and wrap around turtle's back. Thank you. So, questions or comments? Oh, we have a mic. I believe because it's being recorded that you will need to make your questions, unless of course you don't want it to be on tape, that would be okay, and we won't tape it.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. At one point in your book, you're speaking of indigenous technologies during birth using like the shawl, and you also mention using a candle to cauterize.
Yes, I see you now. Okay.
Okay. To cauterize the umbilical cord, mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that because I wasn't sure exactly what that entailed.
Well, it's burning a candle to cut the cord. And so a lot of communities may not have a sterile environment in Mexico and other places. And so that was a technology that was traditionally used to ensure that they weren't using a contaminated, let's say, steel implement. Well, I won't talk about the Ant Society per se, because we're being recorded. I'm just giving that as an example, and I think those societies should speak for themselves. It is in the literature, so I mention it. But let me talk more from a Nahua perspective, which has been recorded, okay? And so, not so much the, more the respect given to an anthill can be associated with illnesses that come from winds. Illnesses that come from wind or air, and there can be skin eruptions. But sometimes when there is this imbalance with winds, it is also associated with emotions. So apart from the sickness that might come from having somehow been inappropriate to an anthill, you can get things associated with thinking your brain, kind of like wind in the brain, for lack of a better way to explain it. And this could be strong emotions. And so when we talk about a wind illness, when you're very, if you're upset, a lot of times you're breathing in a lot, and it's a wind. Whether it's sighing or even anger, you know, you can breathe in a lot from that, and so it can create an imbalance.
I'm curious, is there your kind of traditional medicine to cover pretty much any kind of illness, or are there times when you find Western medicine might be helpful, or is it not?
Oh, I think, I think a lot of traditional healers in Mexico, they'll even, you don't have to have a doctor to prescribe something from the pharmacy, and they'll use certain allopathic medicine. I think that there's times when they are compatible in the sense they can be complementary, or they can be they can coexist. And I think that emotional dysfunctions are an example of that. And I've seen people respond really well to getting therapy and then getting a limpia ceremony or ongoing ceremonies with the temezcal and other purification ceremonies to almost take away the emotions that are brought up. A person becomes very raw and open, and so by doing traditional medicine after they've had some therapy that's brought up a lot of things, it actually allows them to release that which they've been holding on to. So that's an example of how it can work together. Sometimes allopathic medicine is required, and I think there are traditional healers who recognize that also. Yeah. Sometimes interventions have to happen in birth. It's not like a lot of us who are birth workers understand. There are times when our natural efforts are there. Something more may be needed depending on the situation.
I know that in many Mesoamerican traditions, there's often this balance of opposites. Within the traditions of bringing life into the world, is there that equal balance within the same teachings for birthing the life into the next world, or those people that are getting ready to pass on? Is that part of that body of knowledge, or is that a completely separate person that does that?
For going into the next world?
Yes.
I think it varies. I think it varies a lot on people's traditions. Sometimes midwives are the person that does that in some traditions because birth potentially can be death, right? But I think it really varies. I think that what you see in Mexico that's very distinct from other places is a certain familiarity and comfort with the ability to reconcile death. And that's, you know, Dia de Muertos has become this social event, and yet it has very specific, very profound and physically challenging ceremonies that when they are done traditionally, to honor those that have gone into the spirit world, it still exists among certain people who maintain those traditions. So while you see that kind of joking around with death and the parades and the dressing up as calaveras and that kind of thing, that is only like the outward veneer. And now, of course, it's kind of grown into something else in the United States. But that ceremony of death, and I love what Gudgy Cook says, and she's a Mohawk midwife who's very familiar with the Mesoamerican traditions. And she says that people who have strong death traditions have strong birth traditions. And you see that in Mexico and Central America and, you know, what we know as Mesoamerica. I do think that the power to, in a family, when there is that balance, it's an important balance to maintain and is one that we need to reclaim as part of that returning to knowledge. And in the sense that there is a place for all of us to have in prayer in one way or the other. And I think that's very comforting. When my Uncle Joe passed away, we were constantly by his side, and he got to die at home. And he was very proud of being a Kickapoo man. And he helped to keep that knowledge alive of who we were. And so we really honored him by people staying with him and him having the right to not be in a hospital, right? I have helped people go to the other side who were men and elders because there was nobody because the family asked me to, you know. So it was really because of that they trusted me and they asked me to come and pray for him. And so it's interesting because there is one teaching that says, in certain instances, when a man is sick, a woman should do the healing. And when a woman is sick, the man should do the healing. So it's another way to understand the balance of the male and the female. So there's different ways to understand these things.
Oh, I was just wondering, when I read this and came here and it talked, when you mentioned healing, I thought of traditional illnesses need healing. Like, to me, birthing is a beautiful ceremony, and I love the way you talked about it, but I don't consider that a sickness. I consider that normal. Mm-hmm. But I was wondering how you deal with some of the common things like heart disease, hypertension, and maybe cancer. How does your healing or your
tradition
yeah. Deal with those things.
Yeah. Well, you should come tomorrow because I'm going to talk about traditional heart health tomorrow. But I'll talk about it a little bit right now. Many of our illnesses come from our heart and our feelings, and also what our parents were experiencing and their emotions at the time of conception. And so Doña Enriqueta, our very respected Zapotec midwife, she says, for instance, certain illnesses such as lupus, that can be genetically passed, that we understand as being genetically passed on in a Western framework, which could be brought on by environmental toxins also. But she talks about, in fact, that it being its origins in the person's state of life at the time of conception. So now, of course, we're looking at the health since preconception, right? People are looking at the importance of preconception in people's health. And with this growing field of epigenetics, seeing that if your grandparents went through some kind of famine or extreme hardship, how certain genes can be turned on in future generations for health, certain kinds of health propensities for health issues, right? So even if we understand that and we try to see the parallels with an indigenous framework, we can see that that truly we can carry the sickness of our elders into the next lifetime, including trauma. And so cancer, aside from being out of balance with nature, which has brought on cancer, it also is understood as, for instance, being the result of trauma that's matured. It's called being matured. In other words, it's trauma that has set for a long time, what people would call chronic. And so it's much harder to deal, to address in a ceremonial way or in a traditional way, because it's had a long time to accumulate in the body and a force, a kind of a depth to it. But Doña Enriqueta and other midwives talk about breast cancer and, you know, women who have had a lot of suffering. And so our breast tissue is near our heart, and, you know, we're feeling things in our heart, and how, you know, it can bring on breast cancer. Diabetes is looked on as a disease that it can be a result of a susto or a trauma that happened decades prior and that finally manifests later. And, you know, they look at stress-induced, the manifestation of diabetes as a result of stress. That's already been documented also. So that said, it doesn't mean it can't be treated, but that's kind of a way to understand the importance of maintaining balance with each other and balance with our environment.
They use food. Is food a big thing? Because that seems to be, you know, such a upcoming, or you hear that now.
Yeah.
You are what you eat, and there's all kinds of diets.
Yeah.
I was wondering if the healers like for diabetics and
we have wonderful foods. Cactus is not only help to balance the blood sugar. It's a tonic for the heart. And one of its names, have you ever noticed the cactus that grow like a heart? Right? One of its names actually references the heart in its Nahuatl name. And so eating nopales is actually good for your digestion, your heart, your pancreas, and your lungs. It can be good it has so many uses. Rosemary, I'm going to talk about this tomorrow. Even though it was a European herb, we internalized it across the Americas into our ecosystem, and it's a tonic for the brain, the heart, the skin, the lungs, the uterus, and in Germany, I think they use it a lot for the heart also. So there's definitely a lot of foods that are given. We know to eat amaranth. Amaranth's really good for the heart. Amaranth greens. We have a real tradition of eating huautli, and in our tacos, and and drinking, you know, I've seen the U.S. attempt at making aguas frescas in the Whole Foods, and they just still haven't gotten it. But we drink a lot of those kinds of things also, as food is medicine, truly. Food is medicine, yeah. And herbs. But not just the herbs, then there's the love. See, there's a secret ingredient to Mexican Indian medicine, and that is prayer and love. That's our secret ingredient, because our mothers often gave us those teas with love. Yeah.
You were talking before about diseases that are passed along to generations. With the healing ceremonies, is it possible to clear ancestral bloodlines of those diseases?
I'm sorry, can you just repeat the last part?
Do you have healing ceremonies where it's possible to clear ancestral bloodlines?
In other words, to go back across generations?
Yes, to clear diseases that are being transmitted.
And do you want to go back in time to your ancestors who passed away, or to go into the future to the ones that come?
Both. At least from present to past.
Present to past, as you go back and heal the past.
Mm-hmm. Do the healing ceremonies, are they? geared to do that?
Yeah. You can heal, you can go back in time and undo something for another person. Mm-hmm. It might not change. I can't speak about it changing the present generation, but it could change future generations. And if the person in this present time starts to do ceremonies to heal themselves and their ancestors, then let's say they have children, then they will have done preventative medicine for their children. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, there was somebody up here who wanted.
Where?
Okay, after you then.
Yeah.
I guess I'm just wondering, like, when you do the ceremonies, like you were saying, with rape or traumas, if you do a ceremony, does the more you do it, the more it takes the pain away or the traumas, or do you see a difference after one ceremony, or?
You know, I have to say that I never know what's going to happen. It's the power of the universe and the power of that person being able to let go and being moved in some ways, and another person not, might not be moved. I did a ceremony. I was doing using the rebozo to show. It as a sacred technology, and unexpectedly someone started to release trauma, and so that's how powerful the Sha was, and so then I had to go into helping them with the trauma at that moment. And so when you were asking about the connection with birth and illness, the reason why I deal a lot with imbalance in red medicine is because you can't understand birth without also understanding what happens to create illness. Because if that happens, we have to be able to treat the mom. And so I've seen people shift. I've seen people let go. I've seen people be able to feel lighter. I've seen people have kind of, you know, not that noticeable of an effect, but over time, if we continue to do the ceremonies, having other subtle shifts in the way their level of happiness. I've seen people have dramatic development of moving away from the suffering in just that first ceremony, and then in future ceremonies, it's not as dramatic because that was that first one that allowed them to go into the depths of life, and the other ones might not be, and it really depends.
Will you talk about the different things that you have on your table, or those kind of things you don't talk?
Since we're recording, and they are things that are sacred. There is one thing I'll talk about. This little obsidian egg. So when I'm talking about the limpias, sometimes they use eggs to rub the body with to take off the illness and herbs. But people are, you know, we as indigenous people continue to be innovative. And so now this obsidian, which is a very important medicine in Mexico, now people are making eggs so that they don't have to buy eggs because eggs, you know, are food and it's expensive. So some people will use a stone egg now instead of the egg. And they use other things for purification. But what I want you to know about this obsidian is that this obsidian is both hot and cold. Meaning it has an internal property that it can maintain heat or heat up when it's next to the body, or it can cool down and become very cold. So, you know, you all have heard of stone massage. Well, we have that too. In fact, we invented it. I mean, indigenous people invented it, you know. And so you might start to heat this up, but if that person needs to be cooled down, it will not stay hot. It will cool. Now, how does that stone know? How does that stone know to respond? Is it our body temperature pulling out coldness? Is it our body temperature somehow interacting and warming it up? It really speaks to the intelligence of this obsidian or the human body. Right? And that is the unknown. That is the unseen. It's unexplainable by Western terms, and yet it happens. And I've seen this in birth, you know. I've seen it when we shouldn't, when it wasn't the right time to advance the labor, this stone would not heat up. It would just immediately go cold. Just it would, you know, it would get a little warm, and then it would just, it was like a light going out, like on a candle. The mic over there.
The native healers, do they only heal peoples of their tribe, or will they heal anyone?
Okay, I'm sorry. Will the native healers, do they only heal people of their tribe, or will they heal anyone?
Oh, it varies, but I think a lot of it's based on relationships. Some where the villages have more kind of tourism, they may be more open to that, and in others, people may be very private about that because of the former persecution of healers. You know, it's only been recent that people have been able to openly practice their medicine. But they knew within their community who to go to, right? So if you're not from that community and you just suddenly knock on the door, like a lot of other places, they might say, well, there's nobody here, you know, or, you know, just not really respond.
Do you draw a distinction between healing and curing? And if so, what would that be?
Nah. No. People can die and they're cured, right? Because they've come into balance with their creator and their children and the people around them. My uncle, the question about cancer is very much connected to emotions, aside from all that's polluted our bodies. and I've seen my own relatives, when they made peace with their families, they were given months, you know, and they made peace and didn't carry that anger that had been there for so long. And they've outlived, you know, other people, numerous other people. Just by going back into balance with the family members. So there is definitely a strong emotional component to your ability, your body's ability to fight off something like cancer if it's out of balance with the people that you love.
Okay. Well, we're gonna wrap up now so that we can have some time for, in case you're interested in purchasing a book. And having a book signed, but I just wanted to let you all know about two more events that we have as part of our programming for this week on the Southwest, and that is tomorrow we have a luncheon, Ficcionados luncheon at noon, that will be focused on aging and sort of traditional approaches to dealing with aging in the Southwest. And then on Thursday evening we have a screening of a film. And that's at 7:30 in the screening room in the Cornerstone Arts Center. And that is a screening of Bless Mi Ultima, which is based on a novel by Rodolfo Anaya, which deals with a lot of these topics that Patrisia has discussed today and will be discussing tomorrow around traditional medicine. But it's more of a sort of cinematic representation of that, so it might answer some of the questions that people have sort of come up with in their sort of first experiences or this time learning about these types of practices. So please do come by, join us, and we hope to continue these conversations. So thank you very much, and let's give Patrisia a warm thank you.
Thank you.